very much. Good morning, and I welcome members to the 27th meeting in 2015 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. As always, ask members to switch off mobile phones, please. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. It's proposed the committee takes items 7 to 12 in private. Item 7 will allow the committee to consider further the delegated powers contained in the Land Reform Scotland Bill. Item 8 will enable the committee to consider further the delegated powers provisions in the Higher Education Governance Scotland Bill. Item 9, the committee to consider a draft report on the Community Justice Scotland Bill to the Justice Committee. Item 10 is for the committee to consider a draft report on the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill to the Health and Committee and Sport Committee. Item 11 is a report on the work considered by the committee during the parliamentary year 2014-15. And item 12 will allow the committee to consider the evidence received on the Succession Scotland Bill today and in previous weeks. Does the committee agree to take these items in private, please?
And John. Could I, yes, while of course agreeing, convener, could I just say about item 7, the Land Reform Scotland Bill, I'd just like to put on the record that I'm concerned in a way that perhaps this is one of the most incomplete bills ever considered by our Parliament. There are many, many policy areas still under development, I think about five. We as a committee exist to scrutinise, and we cannot do so when so much is not available for scrutiny. In several areas, there are potentials to breach ECHR, and therefore I'm extraordinarily concerned about this bill, fundamental weaknesses.
Thank you for those observations, which we will consider when we get to item 7. With that, then, we turn to agenda item 2, which is the Succession Scotland Bill. And we are today receiving oral evidence from the Scottish Government in the persons of Paul Wheelhouse, who's the Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs. Good morning, Minister. Jill Clark is the team leader of Civil Reform Unit, and Catherine McGregor, Solicitor, Constitutional and Civil Law. Good morning again, ladies. You've been diligent observers of what's gone on in the past. Minister, I think you might want to make an opening statement.
I'd be grateful for a very brief one, convener. I would like to thank the committee for inviting me today to give evidence on this bill. I welcome the fact that it's been recognised that this bill will make the law on succession fairer and more consistent, and that such reform is perhaps overdue. The committee is well aware of the approach we've taken in respect of this work. Progressing the law in two separate pieces of legislation and consecutively has the benefit of not causing any further delay on a set of uncontentious reforms and ensuring the level of scrutiny that the bill deserves. The advantages in this approach, we feel, have also been recognised by other witnesses. Taking forward two potential pieces of legislation in quick succession begs the question about consolidation, and that is certainly something we will consider in the context of any future bill in this area. I have been very impressed by the careful questioning of the committee, which has helpfully teased out a number of issues, particularly around the inclusion of a guardian within Section 1 provisions, some of the jurisdictional issues, the clarity on uncertainty as it relates to the survivorship provisions, and whether or not Section 3 relating to the rectification of a will should be extended to homemade wills. On this latter point, I have to confess, I had been unaware of the range and extent of the DIY will market, and the growth in online templates. And there are also differences in the services offered by these sites and whether or not it includes a solicitor who ultimately drafts the will. So it's only right, though, as the committee has highlighted, that we take account of technological changes when formulating our policy. Similarly, it's been very interesting to follow a debate around some of the terminology. I mentioned above the term uncertain, and while I'm clear that Lord Wheatley has helpfully put the term beyond doubt, I very much agree with the sentiments expressed by the committee that legislation shouldn't just be for the legally qualified, but that we need to sense check things. And in this regard, at least, I think there is clarity, I hope, about uncertainty, if that's not to confuse matters, and that the concept is one that the majority of people can understand. And that's why on these particular issues and on a number of other points highlighted, we are continuing to reflect on whether or not the bill requires amendment, and we're open to further views on any of these issues. Finally, as a bill subject to the Scottish Law Commission bill procedure, I would of course be interested in the committee's views on any changes which took the provisions beyond those set out as recommendations in the 2009 report on succession. So, convener, myself and my officials would be very pleased to take any questions.
Thank you very much for that brief statement, which of course covers some of the areas which I'm sure colleagues will want to question you on more closely. I think you've already covered the issue of whether or not you'd want to consolidate this. Certainly that's something which we as a committee would want to encourage the government to do. Generally speaking, we'd want to encourage the government to consolidate the law anyway. Can I ask, therefore, how you feel about the issuing of guidance? Because clearly this is an issue that's going to affect the general public as well as practitioners, and is indeed the case that every one of us should make a will. So how can these changes and others be put in front of the general public so they understand the need to act, please?
I think that's a very important point. As I said in my opening statement, I think we need to make laws as understandable as we can, not just, you don't have to be legally qualified to understand what your rights and responsibilities are. So I share the view it's important to make provisions in the bill accessible to the public. We're therefore considering carefully how we can use our succession website and succession publications to disseminate the changes in law in an easy to understand way. And in addition, should there be further changes to the scheme of succession in Scotland, we'll be considering other methods of dissemination aimed at getting the information across more widely, and we'll also include these changes as part of that work. I'm also just want to draw the committee's attention to the documentation we produce, which is called What to Do After Death, which could be updated and refreshed just to make that current as well. So that's advice that's available to members of the public in the event they do suffer a bereavement. And we're also very grateful for the kind offer made by the Scottish Law Commission to help produce any guidance that may be necessary to ensure that lay people and not just legal practitioners understand the law once the bills are in force.
Yes, it's tempting to suggest, Minister, that there should be a rather more important document called What to Do Before Death. Because this does actually affect all of us, and there are some inevitabilities in life. On that wonderful note, I wonder whether we could go to John Mason to consider Section 1, please.
Thank you, Convener. And I note, Minister, that you did refer to Guardians and Section 1, and that was really what I wanted to ask you about. There are provisions in wills appointing guardians, and this is included in the scope of Section 1. And as a committee, we've heard various arguments suggesting that, in fact, this should not be the case. And some of these arguments have included, for example, that step-parents might have to resort to expensive and time-consuming court action, and also that it would introduce an inconsistency in the law when compared to the approach to guardianship provisions in deeds other than wills. So I just wondered if you could maybe tease out for us what the rationale was for including the provisions in guardianship under Section 1, and given what you've heard in the evidence that we've had, are you still content that this is the correct approach?
Well, I'm actually grateful that John Mason's brought this issue up, because I think it is a very important one. We are continuing to reflect on the views which have been expressed about whether the appointment of a former spouse or civil partner as the guardian of a child should be set out as an exception to the Section 1 rule. And this would only be the case where one of the parents has accepted the child or children as part of the family and do not have parental rights and responsibilities already. On the one hand, the Scottish Government share the view of the Scottish Law Commission that it must be assumed on divorce that as legal separation severs all ties between the testator and their ex-spouse or civil partner, it was not the testator's intention for them to be appointed as the guardian of the child unless they have made express provision in their will under Section 1(3). This, in our view, provides a more equitable outcome, which is more likely to be in line with the testator's wishes. Having said this, we acknowledge the concerns raised in evidence to the committee that the appointment of a guardian can be made not only in a will, but in a separate documentation, that there is a risk of treating guardians differently according to what documentation has appointed them. So we're continuing to think very carefully about the equity of this approach and whether or not in these circumstances the remedy of an application to the court for guardianship is proportionate. I do appreciate the significance of the issue with step-parents or civil partners or others who have been in a situation where they have had a role with a child, and that we need to continue to reflect on those matters and consider whether we need to make any changes to the bill.
Yeah, I mean, I appreciate your comments. I mean, I think there is just a feeling that, you know, families are becoming more complex these days, and I mean, step-parents are actually quite a regular feature now. I don't think it's that exceptional that something like this could turn up.
Absolutely. I recognise that in my own family, indeed. So it's certainly a common feature of society today, and we need to reflect the modern society we live in. So I take that board on board that point.
And what about the fact that, you know, is that there are other deeds that affect guardianship? I mean, is this in fact the right bill to bring all of this into?
Well, I mean, we certainly think that the bill is making some important and you know, largely technical adjustments, which bring it into line with current experience within society. But as to whether it's the best vehicle, we obviously are looking at more fundamental review succession in a separate consultation, as the members are aware. So we do have opportunities to look again at issues in the near future. But I believe the measures that are in here are proportionate and are largely non-contentious, and hopefully will take forward the law succession in the interim, and will withstand any subsequent succession bill as well.
Okay, thank you.
Right, I think we turn to John Scott for consideration of the timing of revocation, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Our committee has heard mixed views about what point Section 1 should take effect from. Arguments on both sides have made reference to what is more consistent with the broader framework of private international law, and also what is more challenging in practical terms for practitioners to deal with. Can you explain what process the government went through in order to formulate its approach as set out in Section 1?
Is this in respect to specifically the domicile issue that Mr. Scott's referring to? Scottish Law Commission were of the view that in order to provide an appropriate link with Scotland, this rule should apply where the testator dies domiciled in Scotland, regardless of where the divorce, dissolution or annulment took place. And as long as it is recognised in Scotland, and we agree with the view of the Scottish Law Commission in that respect, the rationale for the approach is that this provision relates to the law of succession, and it therefore makes better sense for domicile at death to be the determining factor. And I note that the committee has taken evidence on this point and received a mix of responses. We were encouraged that both Professors Crawford and Carruthers, who are specialists in private international law, agreed that the domicile at death was preferable. And they helpfully pointed out the link to subsection 5 and the requirement for the divorce to have taken place within the United Kingdom or otherwise to be recognised in Scotland. And we consider that the combined effect of a divorce recognised in Scotland and a person who is domiciled in Scotland at the point of death is a sensible rule which provides the necessary connection to Scotland and is consistent with the treatment of succession law generally. So this approach, therefore, we believe, at least Convener, provides consistency, and hence that's the rationale for the approach we've taken on this issue.
So you're not persuaded in any way by Trustpower's arguments for an alternative approach in that regard?
Well, we would continue to listen to the views of the committee. Clearly, if the committee has strong view that counters the position we've taken today and that of Professor Crothers and Professor Crawford, we will listen to that view. But as it stands, we believe this is the correct approach, Convener and Mr. Scott.
Thank you for putting the government's view on the record. Clearly, we will shortly be reflecting on the totality of the evidence, and if we feel we need to impress something else on you, we'll say so. Could we now turn to the court's power to rectify the will with Richard, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. A number of witnesses have argued for both for reasons of principle and for practical reasons too, that the current scope of sections 3-4 of the bill should be expanded to include wills prepared by the testator themselves, including those prepared using online forms or software packages. And I understand from your opening comments you've become more aware of some of the great variety of these yourselves. Do I take from your earlier comments that you've accepted the case made for the expansion of the scope of these provisions, or what are your views on that now, Minister?
Well, I think it is an important issue that Mr. Baker raises, and we have actually, reflected on the views expressed by others to the committee. And as I say, I was, as Mr. Baker has highlighted, quite surprised at the range of options that people have available to them, and in particular in relation to online templates. We have looked at a variety of websites, some of which involve a solicitor preparing a will, some of which involve responding to a questionnaire from which a will is drawn up by a will writing company, and others where a template is simply completed and printed with no third-party intervention as such. We think that as many of those who've appeared before the committee have said, evidence of something lost in translation between the testator and the person preparing the will is the key to this provision. So subsections 3.1b and D set this out, and the testator instructs what they want included in the will. Someone else prepares the will based on those instructions, and the court is satisfied that the will fails to give effect to those instructions. So if there was a breakdown in communication, in a sense, it's dealing with those provisions. Some online wills would therefore be included where the above criteria are met. So if there was some dubiety as to how well it had been interpreted. Where a testator draws up their own will themselves, whether on paper or online, this provision would not apply. And we are content that is the right outcome, and that the provision itself is clear on that point, because there is no possibility of misinterpretation if the person has filled the will in themselves, in a sense. In terms of whether software could be considered as constituting a third party, we'll continue to reflect on that point, convener. It's one that I think is bring us firmly into the 21st century in terms of our need to think on these issues. But we think it's unlikely it would be the case at this point. The important fact here is the involvement of another person other than the testator. And we would, of course, be happy to add something to the explanatory notes to confirm the position if the committee feels that needs clarified.
I think that might well be a helpful convener. So the key issue is that there's another person at the end of the process.
That's my understanding.
Stuart might have a question on this point. Is that okay?
I just wondered, if I may, convener, to explore the nature of the other person that you're seeking to catch. It seemed, on the basis of evidence the committee has had, that the legal profession are of the view that it should be somebody who has failed to exercise the professional standards in an appropriate way. In other words, that the other person that might be caught by this provision is somebody who, I'm not sure these words were used, but I will use them, who's legally qualified. Is that the way the government is currently seeing it? And that's the first part of my question.
I think to date, I'll stand corrected by Jill and Catherine if this is incorrect, but I think to date, in the framing of the legislation, we haven't thought in those terms. The presence of someone else, if you like, to verify that the person's intent was different from what ultimately was being exercised in the will. I suppose that's the key issue here, whether they're legally trained or not, that there's someone there to say, well, actually, I don't believe that's what the person intended, and therefore it's potentially possible to argue for a revocation of the provisions if they were inaccurately delivered. But I take the point on board. I maybe ask, if I may, convener, with your consent, bring in Jill Clark on this point, just if there's anything she wishes to add.
Yeah, the Minister is absolutely right. We don't have a view that it need be a legally qualified person. It could be a lay person. I think it's that lost in translation and whether there's evidence that would show that something didn't translate as the testator wished.
Pursue that then and then come back to Stuart's point about the real question. If I've heard you right, what you're suggesting is the important bit is that there is a person who might stand up in court and give some evidence rather than a person who actually wrote something down and provided some advice and was a scribe.
I mean, the evidence may not be the person. It may be that there's a draft, that piece of paper that shows one thing and then a final will that shows something different. But it may well be a person, yes.
Okay, sorry.
I'm now going to make things dramatically more complicated because, of course, in other parts, and we'll come to discuss this, we talk about heritable property that is not within Scotland. But, of course, if you turn that the other way around, there will be heritable property in Scotland where the will that is seeking to affect its disposition was instructed and is being primarily considered by a jurisdiction out with Scotland. And I just wonder how this works, because it will be Scots law and possibly the Scots courts who ultimately interpret a non-Scottish will in relation to heritable property. How does the same issue touch upon it? And I, in particular, the example I had in my mind is that just as the writers of the signet have a tradition, in places like India, where literacy levels are comparatively low, most villages will have a writer who has a public stall on the high street for the illiterate. And I wonder how we deal with the any challenge to the translation between the testator's intention and what is ended up on the bit of paper will be dealt with in relation to heritable property in Scotland where the will has been constructed in another jurisdiction? Or am I making this so complicated that it's an unreasonable question?
It's not an unreasonable question, but it would just work as it does at the moment, you know, where someone might challenge a will and live in a foreign jurisdiction. So Catherine will correct me, but the law as it stands will just operate in the same way as it does and will continue to do so. So whatever jurisdictional standards apply will continue to apply.
So really, just to be clear then, and perhaps to close it off, that what is in this bill and what the government might do to the bill will not remove other rectification approaches that are not covered by the bill but are covered by existing law, in particular by case law.
Absolutely not.
That's correct. Yeah. That's correct.
I'm wondering if we go back to Richard, in whose hands... John, is this specifically on this case? Yes, okay. Yes, right.
Forgive me, and I'm possibly asking not... an ill-advised question. It wouldn't be the first time, but is there a change in emphasis from what you said before Stuart Stevenson's last question about the weight you're giving to the intent of a testator? Is there a change in emphasis on that? It just seems you said if there are previous writings or something. Is that as it currently is, or is there a change in emphasis there?
I believe that you know if there was that would currently apply with the existing law. I think we're dealing with the provisions in relation to the new technology that's available, where potentially a will could be generated in the absence of a third party. It may be entirely technologically driven through the software, and there's no one had any intervention to be able to understand what the intent of the testator was in framing their will, versus a situation where there is some other human involvement, where someone is possibly able to testify to the extent that they were sure the testator meant something different from what was ultimately put into the will. If there's maybe a fault in the software and a provision is dropped when someone actually submits it, and that's not spotted by the testator when they submit it, then potentially, hypothetical example, that they may be able to say, well, actually, I know that person intended to have a provision in there and could prove it, perhaps because they'd seen the draft notes of the person was using to fill in the template. But I think I can maybe just confirm through Joel Clark, if I may, convener, that the position regarding the other writings is similar to the current position.
Yes, it is indeed. Some of the examples that the Scottish Law Commission use in their report refer to, you know, a draft document not being picked up when it was typed up. So there's no change in position there.
Very helpful. Thank you very much.
If we could turn to Richard.
Thank you, Convener. I understand, obviously, you've obviously given this some consideration, Minister, but I think it's fair to say that there was a mix of evidence to committee on this point, and some gave evidence, including Professor Paisley of the University of Odin, about some risks and dangers of expanding the provisions of Section 3 or 4 of the bill, particularly in terms of increasing number of challenges by disappointed beneficiaries on that basis. I mean, obviously, I presume this is something you're giving consideration. So just wondered how you weighed up those arguments.
Yes, I mean, and this is a similar situation applies to the homemade wills as well. That I believe in terms of that provision, certainly Scottish Law Commission was persuaded by the argument it'd be very difficult to obtain sufficient evidence to satisfy a court of the need to rectify a homemade will. I guess similar issues apply in relation to online as well, but recommend it only relate to a will prepared by someone other than the testator. And we certainly agree that the power to rectify a will should be confined to cases where the will has been prepared by someone other than the testator, where a comparison can be made through the presence maybe of someone or documentation between the testator's instructions and the will itself to prove there's a discrepancy between what was intended and what was ultimately delivered. And without this, we do fear, and I suspect this is where Mr. Baker is also fearful, that it's foreseeable that unentitled persons may seek to raise actions disputing the terms of a will purely on the basis they do not benefit under the will. and it'd be difficult to deal with that in that situation.
Thank you. And finally, no, it's not finally, it's my penultimate question from you, actually, Convener. In terms of how you're achieving the policy objectives you laid out, and you provided clarity there on the scope of sections 3 to 4, you said you're going to amend the explanatory notes. Does that actually require a change in legislation as well? There's some uncertainty at committee whether, in terms of achieving that policy intention, you have to amend sections 3 to 4, or whether actually it's already captured there and it's going to be a question of more details in explanatory notes.
At the risk of being corrected by my colleagues, I don't believe that we need to amend the legislation to provide a change to explanatory notes, but I'll just check that that's correct with my colleagues. I believe so.
Moving on time limits.
Yes, please.
In terms of rectification, convener. Section 4.1 of the bill provides that an application for rectification must be made within the period of 6 months following the grant of confirmation or in any other case from the date of the testator's death, with the court having discretion to extend this time limit. A number of witnesses, Minister, have argued that the time limit associated with sections 3 to 4 should run from the date of death and not from the date of confirmation, and various alternative lengths of time limit have been proposed to the committee. So just given the weight of evidence that we've received on this topic, just to ask Minister if you're minded to reconsider the bill's approach on this matter.
I would say, in response to Mr. Maker's very fair point, the basic policy is that applications for rectification should be made within a reasonable time, and the six-month period was drawn from recommendation 51 of the Scottish Law Commission report. We do note, however, that the Trust Bar have raised concerns in the written evidence that if the confirmation does not take place for a number of years, this may result in an application for rectification taking place after a period of 6 months, and others have agreed with that position, as Mr. Baker has indicated. But the opposite view has also been set out by Elise Scobie on the basis that a will only becomes a public document on confirmation unless a solicitor voluntarily registers the will on death. We were encouraged by the view from Professor Paisley that were an executor or other individual who willfully cause a delay in confirmation, these would likely be circumstances in which the courts may extend the time limit on cause shown. On the basis that the court has the power to waive the time limit on cause shown, we think the bill provisions give effect to the SLC recommendation of the rectification occurring within a reasonable time, and I quote. It's worth remembering that the bill contains two potential starting points, and I think Mr. Baker alluded to this. Where confirmation is required, it's the date of confirmation, and where it is not required, it's the date of death. So for small estates, the time limit will be 6 months from death, subject, of course, to the court's power to waive that. So I hope that clarifies the government's position on the issue, but I do recognise it's something that's not had a consensus.
Thank you.
Thank you. Again, I think that hopefully just clarifies, as you say, the government's position, and we'll go away and reflect on how we see that. I think we then turn to John Mason, please, on protection of third
Thanks,
parties.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, the area of protection for third parties acquiring property, and that's dealt with in sections 3, 4 and 19, I think. Again, Trustbar have raised a question about this, and I mean, they're arguing that there is a deficiency because there's only really partial protection offered to third parties acquiring property who might be prejudiced by a subsequent rectification. Now, their suggestion is it would be better to apply Sections 8 and 9 of the Law Reform Miscellaneous Provisions Scotland Act 1985 to wills, I think on the grounds that that would offer better protection, and already is a lot of case law around that legislation. Therefore, wouldn't it be better to extend it into this area rather than doing something completely new? So I just wonder if you have any thoughts about that.
I do indeed, Convener, and I'm grateful to Mr. Mason for raising this point. As a beneficiary under the will as executed is obliged under the law of unjustified enrichment to restore any bequest or the value of the bequest to the executor if he or she is not a beneficiary under the will as rectified. The aim of the measure is to ensure that the rightful beneficiary receives the property that they were entitled to, and the need to protect that person's rights outweighs any property rights of the beneficiary who was not entitled to receive the bequest. Trustbar did submit that, as Mr. Mason indicated, that Section 9 of the Law Reform miscellaneous provisions, Scotland Act 1985, gives protection to third parties, and a court may only rectify a will where the interests of a person to whom this section applies would not be adversely affected to a material extent by the rectification, and no similar protection exists under Sections 3 and 4 of the Bill. We are of the view, however, that the Bill provides adequate protection to third parties who rely on a will which is subsequently rectified. Section 3 expressly protects a third party who derives title from a beneficiary under will that is subsequently rectified. In addition to this, the rectification is at the discretion of the court, who will have regard to the rights of all those affected. Section 19 of the Bill, to which Section 3(4) expressly provides third party protection, in the example provided, I refer to that, in the example provided by Trust Bar and Oral Evidence last week, their concern was in respect to a person who acquired a loan for the value of the property they were going to inherit, as it's put, and subsequently the will was rectified. As you yourself noted last week, Convener, if this was a loan in contemplation of inheritance, there would be no protection against the asset, and this section does not apply. If it was after Party B had acquired the title, B would be protected by Section 19(2)(b) of the legislation. So we believe we covered the angle in terms of third-party protection. I hope that puts on record something which addresses Mr Mason's concerns.
Yep, fair enough.
Could I just pursue that? Forgive me if I've understood it correctly. If I inherit a significant amount of money and I've actually received that inheritance from a will, which is going to be rectified and take that away, if I've then set up in business in such a way as to tie up that money, which I'm then required to give back, that leaves me in trouble and my creditors around me in trouble. I haven't acquired it for value, but I have acquired it under the estate. And all sorts of packs of cards fall down because I've got to give the money back, but I've no longer got the money. I've dispersed it into a business. Is that the intention?
Convener, if I may, I think I'd probably like to just reflect with colleagues on that particular example, make sure I'm not giving a misinstruction to the committee or ill-advised response, maybe in line with Mr Scott. If I can just double-check. Perhaps if I may, think just not a miscommunication, if I'll bring in Catherine McGregor on this point.
Yeah, please do.
Yeah, sorry, if I could just confirm, is this in respect to the point where if somebody incurs debt in advance of inheritance or an assumption they're going to inherit and then subsequently do not inherit as a result of
I'm with you entirely on that argument,
okay.
Which I think we articulated last week.
Yes.
No, I'm in the situation where I have inherited it. I have actually been given my £100,000 mm-hmm. or whatever it is, but the court is going to rectify that will and I'm going to have to give my £100,000 back, which I didn't mm-hmm. otherwise have, mm-hmm. and I've now dispersed that into a business. Not a particular asset that I can sell, but just genuinely into the working capital of whatever.
Yep.
That leaves, as I say, a complete pack of cards which is going to have to fall down and there's no way I can actually raise the money.
Yes.
Is that the intention?
That's not the intention. And certainly I had understood that Section 19 would give protection to that individual and subsequently their creditors. But certainly I would like to reflect on that point and we can maybe write to committee subsequently.
My concern is that I've not given value for what I've received.
Yep.
I've just received it as mm-hmm. a benefit, as a gift to me. And those around me will have given some value, but it could in the commercial world be pretty tenuous value. And not just be a bit of a mortgage or whatever, which we could clearly identify. So mm-hmm. don't think that's necessarily an unreasonable example, actually.
No,
but it's a fair point, and we'll look to see if there's any unintended consequences in terms of that particular scenario.
Right, thank you very much. Does that complete, John?
Yeah, that's fine.
That's fine, thank you. So I think we're then going back to John Scott on retrospective effect.
Thank you very much, Convener. In oral evidence, officials from the government clarified that Section 5 is intended to apply only in respect of wills revoked after commencement. Furthermore, the government intends that Section 8 will apply to documents executed on or after commencement. Trustbar has said it is happy with this, subject to the government's intentions appearing on the face of the bill. Is the government minded to amend the bill to reflect this? That is to say,
put these intentions on the face of the bill?
It's a fair question that Mr. Scott raises. We will deal with the application and provisions as part of the commencement order, and the Commission proposed that ministers should appoint a single day for the commencement of the more extensive bill attached to its report on the basis that it formed a package that cannot sensibly be broken down into smaller parts for commencement at different times. As set in our delegated powers memorandum, the Scottish Government considers it likely that it will also take view that provisions should be commenced as a whole. It considers that it's preferable to ensure its flexibility and commencement powers in case it transpires there's any need for staggered commencement. And this also allows for the possibility that there could be amendments made to the bill during its parliamentary passage, which might impact an approach to commencement. But on Section 8 specifically of the bill, implementing Recommendation 60 of the SLC report, the application of the bill provisions will be dealt with in the commencement order. I hope that reassures the member. It's not the policy intention for the section to have retrospective effect. It is the policy intention for the section to only apply to wills executed after the commencement date. Otherwise, testator's wills may not have the effect they intended at the time of drafting the will, and this would require testators to amend their wills, which would be costly. Hence the approach we'll take to putting the application of the provisions in terms of the commencement order and to set out the timing.
Okay, thank you. Moving now to Section 6.2 of the bill, which allows the testator to state in his or her will that Section 6 should not apply. Trustpar has made it a specific point relating to Section 6.2 of the bill, saying that it needs to be revised to give greater clarity about the effect of a legacy of the residue in certain circumstances. What is the Minister's view on Trustpar's suggestions?
We certainly looked at the issue of how Section 6 will operate, perhaps if there is a competing residual legacy, Convener Mr. Scott, and where the specified legatee was a child, niece or nephew of the testator, the common law rule, forgive me using the Latin, conditio si insuitus sine liberis decesserit, operates so as to prefer the descendants of that child, niece or nephew, over an alternative legatee specified in the will, or legatee under a legacy of residue or intestacy under Section 6, which places this rule in a statutory footing with some departures. An alternative legatee will be favoured over the descendants of the child, niece or nephew. Those descendants will, however, be preferred over a residual legatee. And we note, as Mr. Scott has done, Trustpar's evidence here, where they did make the point, as has been identified, that the residue clause should be neutral and should not weight against the testator's deceased son or daughter, so that was destined for them to go to the grandchildren. We don't believe there's any evidence to suggest that this is the would be the case, that there would be more cases being dealt with in the courts or any greater uncertainty. But we are taking on board the comments made by Trustpar last week, and we will give this matter further consideration as we approach stage two to see if we have to make any necessary amendments to address that.
Thank you.
I'm wondering, in pursuit of that, Minister, whether you could comment on the comment, which I think came from Trustpar, that maybe Section 6.1a should read a will identifies as a beneficiary rather than names as a beneficiary. We had some brief discussion about the use of names.
Convener, we certainly are. That's something that one of the issues that we are reflecting on in advance of stage two. We do think it was a fair point that was raised in evidence, and we will come back perhaps to the committee in writing on our view on that.
Thank you. If we could now turn to John Mason on survivorship, please.
Yes, Convener. Sections 9, 10, 11 deal with survivorship, and I've basically got two questions. The first, a kind of general question. Professors Carruthers and Crawford suggested that really there's quite a lot of policy issues in here, and should they therefore really be included in this bill, which is not meant to be a kind of a particularly controversial bill? So I just wonder if you feel that they had a point when they said that.
I recognise the complexity of the issues that Mr. Mason refers to. We are of the view that this is certainly a matter which is capable of being considered under the SSC bill criteria, and therefore within the context of this bill. These recommendations met the criteria we applied when deciding what should form the basis of this consultation, that is, that they are not inextricably linked to the fundamental reform contained in Part 2 and 3 of the SLC report, and will therefore work with the law as it stands today and will apply equally to any new scheme of succession which may be introduced at some point in the future. This is only one of a number of policy issues contained in the bill, however, and we're not of the view shared by respondents to our consultation that this particular policy issue is controversial. Obviously, we'd welcome the committee's view on the issue if the committee feels strongly on it, but we do believe that this is something that is not inextricably linked to the more substantive potential reforms that are subject to the separate consultation, and therefore we believe it's possible to deliver it through this bill and within the spirit of the SLC bill process.
Okay. A specific point also that Trustbar raised, and I think Professor Paisley was supporting them in that, was that the bill should perhaps address the situation where a family perishes together and the estate ends up falling to the Crown rather than to other relatives. And I think the suggestion was made that, you know, nobody in their right mind would want the money to go to the Crown, and that however remote a relative was or whatever, most people would prefer that. Have you any thoughts on that?
Yes, I have to be careful at this point, don't I? Well, we were persuaded that this is a matter which would benefit from further consideration. The key would be in how a rule might be framed. Currently, where an estate is intestate, the estate will fall to be held by the Crown if there are no children, parents, siblings, spouse or civil partner, uncles or aunts, grandparents, brothers and sisters of grandparents or other ancestors. Quite a lengthy list. It is worth noting, though, that the rule will apply in only a very small number of cases. Therefore, the number of cases falling into intestacy, we believe, will be tiny. I think we need to understand what we need to understand is what happens to states which fall to the Crown. They are firstly investigated by the National Ultimus Hieris, is that the correct pronunciation? Hieris unit, and then passed to the Queen's and Lord Treasurer's Remembrancer, or QLTR, perhaps a neater acronym. The QLTR, I will resort to using, administer the estate, paying any debts, etc., and then it will be added to their unclaimed estates list. At that point, these estates are then advertised on the website as, I quote, having fallen to the Crown. But we understand that in fact, the great majority will subsequently be paid to blood relatives. So relatively few end up in the situation ultimately where the assets are retained by the Crown. Noting Mr. Scott's point, I'm representing the Crown in this respect. But clearly, it'd be desirable if assets can go to the family members that perhaps the person who died without a will would have hoped that their assets would have gone to family members. A further point for consideration is that a change of this nature, if it could be robustly and clearly framed, would develop or extend a commission recommendation which might create a tension in terms of remaining within the criteria for a commission stroke delegated powers and law reform committee bill. So we have thought very carefully about what we could sensibly put through your own committee and reasonably put through your own committee without causing concern about lack of consultation on fundamental changes.
Okay, thank you.
So that might not be the final word on this particular issue if it troubles us as a parliament in the future.
Well, certainly I would recognise that if the committee feels strongly on behalf of parliament that further action needed in this, I would look to see that. But we believe the bill as drafted is sound. It's sound in terms of the spirit of the process that we're currently engaged in with this committee. But it also gives effect to a reasonable provision, and we are, certainly, persuaded that it is a matter that would benefit from further consideration. And if the committee do have particularly strong views on it, we would welcome those.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, I think we turn to uncertainty in the capable hands of Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you, convener. Minister, in your opening remarks, you referred to Lord Wheatley putting the meaning of uncertainty in this context beyond doubt. Trustbar, in particular, highlight that it would enhance the certainty if the matter of uncertainty being determined by the balance of probabilities were to be incorporated in the face of the bill. Are the government and yourself minded to think further on that?
Well, it is. I recognise it's a very important issue, and hence, you know, there's been some time devoted to discussing this. We certainly, in terms of the bill providing expressly that the timing of deaths perhaps is uncertain when it cannot be established in the balance of probabilities of one survived the other, we do not consider any changes necessary, as no one is, it would appear, suggesting that the provisions as drafted don't work legally. They do align with the approach taken both the 1964 Act and in the Scottish Law Commission's draft bill, and we believe a very clear explanation of what uncertain means is given in the explanatory notes, and we refer to paragraph 36 specifically. The reader of the bill therefore gets the answer without resorting to the case itself. It's not always possible or desirable for legislation to state everything expressly. To do so can risk undermining the interaction between legislation and the background law in which it operates. And Trustborn made this point themselves by pointing out that it's unnecessary to refer to the balance of probabilities, a point that Mr. Stevenson referred to. Using those words here might give rise to questions about the absence of a corresponding approach elsewhere in the bill in relation to questions of the evidential standard required to provide a legal proposition, approve a legal proposition, I should say. And we believe Professor Carruthers said in her own evidence that it's not always desirable to, and I quote, to put into legislative form a rule that already operates effectively at common law, unquote. Aligning with the approach taken in the 1964 Act ought to guarantee the same legal result, we believe, and changing the wording might introduce a new room for legal argument, for example, established by whom, what does cannot mean, being examples of where there might be an uncertainty created. So we believe it's consistent with the 1964 Act, the approach that's taken, and we hope that the explanatory notes have set out clearly what is intended in paragraph 36.
So in essence, Minister, the standard of proof that prevails in civil courts is on balance of probabilities, and therefore that being the norm catches the cases that are before us in this bill.
I believe so, Convener, and Mr. Stevenson is correct, but I stand corrected if my colleagues believe that's correct.
Nodding. Now, Trustbar and the Law Society also, in looking at sections 9 and 10, are suggesting that one should not trump the other, that there may be circumstances in which both prevail. In particular, 10.4 rules out 10.1b when people die simultaneously or where the order of death is uncertain. And it seemed to me that the effect of 9 and 10 taken together is to tip wills into intestacy where it is asserted the will could probably be used to determine who might inherit beyond the primary people who might inherit. Are you minded to think about the interoperation of 9 and 10 in the light of the remarks that have been made in evidence to the committee so far?
Well, as ever, I continue to reflect on these matters, and certainly I'll be keen to see, you know, the committee's detailed comments on this issue, but for the record, we have listened carefully to those who have offered a view on Section 10.4, including the view that it does not add anything to the bill and it may, as Mr. Stevenson indicated, result or is perceived to result in more cases of intestacy. It may be worth setting out, again for the record, that the intended purpose of Section 10.4 is to achieve the desired policy in a situation when a testator dies in the common calamity with one or other or more people. The policy intention is that is that each deceased person is to be treated as having failed to survive the other. That would have the effect that property is not to be divided equally among their estates, as would be the case in the absence of subsection 4. However, we will give some further consideration to this point, as I say, and whether any amendment is needed. So if the committee are able to give a view as to where they believe, based on the evidence presented, we should go, I will certainly take that into consideration. But we hopefully have set out today what our intent is in relation to 10.4 in the situation where the deceased person is to be treated as having failed to survive the other.
Well, it's not for me to anticipate what the committee may say. There does seem to be a tension between 10.1b and 10.4 that, as a layperson, I'm certainly unable to reconcile.
We would want, convener, the law to be understandable, and clearly if there's uncertainty, we will reflect on that in terms of the evidence that's been presented by the committee.
Very fair point. The law needs to be understandable. If you need a degree in logic, as it were, to work out how on earth this is going to work when you're looking at your own family's affairs, then something's gone wrong somewhere. Yes.
Agreed.
Well, again, I do recall doing a course in logic and metaphysics, but I suspect this tips rather into the metaphysics rather than the logic. Moving rapidly on to forfeiture, and the Scots Law Commission originally wanted to put it on a statutory footing rather than simply tweak certain aspects of it. Does the Minister think that putting it on a statutory footing rather than simply giving the courts 100% discretion, which is currently denied them, is still something that you're considering?
I think, again, that's a very fair question. In their 1990 report, convener, the Scottish Law Commission recommended that the common law forfeiture should be placed on a statutory footing, and at the same time the Parricide Act should be repealed. However, in their 2009 report, the Scottish Law Commission had shifted their position and decided not to recommend placing the common law forfeiture on a statutory footing because it was perceived forfeiture is rare in practice, and having provision for forfeiture in the common law has not created any difficulties to date, at least. We currently share the view of the Scottish Law Commission and note that witnesses in general, appreciate not everybody may be in agreement, but in general are content with this approach.
Professor Paisley suggested that the 1982 Forfeiture Act was one of the, quote, terrible, one of the worst pieces of legislation ever passed by the Westminster Parliament. I think he was seeking to make a point, perhaps, rather than... But he suggested that the traditional common law, personal unworthiness that's in Scots law, is a better sense of judging who might sensibly by the courts be excluded from inheriting after particular circumstances. And just as a footnote, of course, the Parricide Act by no means covers all the circumstances, so I suspect deleting it from the canon of law is not unreasonable.
I think this is a very reasoned point that Mr. Stevens is making. We are aware of the oral evidence on this matter. The personal unworthiness rule that Mr. Stevenson referred to is considered in Consultative Memorandum Number 71, 1986, in Part 2, especially at paragraphs 2.2 to 2.14. And the common law is also mentioned in Part 7 of the 1990 report. For instance, at the end of paragraph 7.5, where examples are given of situations in which it might be useful. The approach of the 2009 report leaves the common law to deal with situations which are not covered by the Forfeiture Act 1982. And I take Mr. Stevenson's comments about the 1982 Act. I'll not add to them in terms of the position today, but there were no recommendations made in respect of personal unworthiness in the Scottish Law Commission's reports, and we are therefore giving the application of this section to the personal unworthiness rule some consideration ourselves, and again it's something we perhaps could return to with the committee in due course.
Thank you. It suggests there are quite a few things you may be coming back on, but that's what we're about. John.
Could I welcome that, because I think Professor Paisley did raise a very forceful point in terms of personal unworthiness, and I'm sure we as a committee would want to be reassured that you have in every way considered every aspect of what he said in terms of personal unworthiness. But I am reassured by what you say, so thank you.
Thank you for that comment.
Right, I think, pardon me, if that concludes forfeiture, I think we're back to John Scott on protection of executors, please, in section 18.
Thank you very much. In section 18, in terms of protection for trustees and executors, there is for the first time an explicit duty on executors and trustees to make reasonable inquiries relating to possible beneficiaries. It's very clear to the committee that advertising is not part of the practitioner's current practice. Are you going to offer any guidance to practitioners who might be concerned about the potential implications of this apparent new duty in Section 18?
This is something that we are we have considered in terms of the evidence provided. There is no requirement to advertise for beneficiaries in Section 18, as Mr. Scott indicates, and it remains to be seen how the duty to make reasonable inquiries would operate in practice. The Scottish Law Commission noted in their 1990 report that the requirement on trustees and executors to make such inquiries as are reasonably necessary in the circumstances would represent at most a slight change in the law. On this basis, reasonable inquiries, unquote, would appear to be a commonly understood term. The Scottish Law Commission considered whether an express duty to advertise was appropriate, but were content that the general duty to make reasonable inquiries was sufficient. They went on to further advise that an express duty to advertise would give undue prominence to that method of pursuing inquiries, and were therefore of the view that the wording in Section 18, and I quote, after such inquiries as any reasonable and prudent trustee would have made in the circumstances of the case, unquote, is sufficient for the purposes of the section and does not require to be defined. Ultimately, what is deemed to be reasonable will fall to be determined by the courts. We understand that it was raised in evidence by Ms. Scobie that you get into a different ballgame, I believe is the term that was used, when people go or have come from abroad. And in respect to this, we feel that the current wording provides sufficient flexibility to make reasonable inquiries in different circumstances. So we are content with the provisions as they stand, but as always, we will listen to the views of the committee on this matter. Hope that's addressed Mr. Scott's question.
It certainly addressed it, but it, as you say, it turns on the word what is reasonable and what are reasonable inquiries likely to be. I'd be disappointed if it was for the courts only to decide, and of course reasonable has many uses in law, in Scots law. I don't really know what I have to say, but I'm just slightly worried that it's perhaps still not sufficiently exact. But
could extend that, you'd commented, Minister, that the SLC thought that this might, if it was anything, be a slight change? Was roughly what you said.
Yeah, so
I'm just wondering, if we're intending to change the law, shouldn't we be explicit about what that slight change is? Because otherwise people don't know those who knew what the law was are in a good place. Those who have to guess take advice. But if we don't know what the slight change is, then we're all in a hole.
We can obviously I'll reflect on that point, convener, and in response to clearly Mr. Scott is concerned about the scope for misinterpretation. We can perhaps reflect on that as to whether that can be dealt with either in explanatory notes or tightened up in terms of the bill itself. But we can come back to the committee on that point, if I may.
Could want to make before I bring Stuart Stevenson, of course, that we around this table represent the normal citizen of Scotland who might well find him or herself as an executor and a trustee without knowing the first thing, possibly quite literally unexpectedly. And always is a bit of a shock. Those people, of whom we may be some, need to have good advice without going to lawyers about what they reasonably need to do. So I think this is an area where we aren't considering what the law says to lawyers. This is how does the ordinary man and woman confronted with this problem
deal with it. I can certainly convene or accept that that's a reasonable position that yourself and Mr. Scott have taken, that we need to make sure that those that do find themselves in a situation where we shouldn't forget they're probably fairly distressed about the loss of a loved one, that the last thing on earth they need is confusion about what should or should not be done. So if there are ways in which we can provide greater clarity on what, from the point of view of the benefit of the executor, as to what steps they might want to take to make sure that the appropriate advertisement was made, then we will look at that.
Thank you.
And come back to committee.
Stuart, did you?
I just wanted to put it to the Minister that what constitute reasonable inquiries will likely change over time as certain kinds of inquiries become more practical. And indeed, 20 years ago, when much less information was available to the ordinary citizen. And I just give an example that 3 or 4 years ago, in a Christmas debate, we identified that there was a missing cousin in our family. And I was able in 30 minutes to identify where they stayed, who they'd married, the names of the children, the telephone number they could be contacted at, and provide a photograph of their house to the member of the family who'd raised the subject. Whereas 20 years ago, it would be beyond contemplation to even initiate such an inquiry. And therefore, we should be very careful, I'm sure, Minister, to allow the courts the discretion to decide at the time what might be reasonable, because we can't anticipate what would be reasonable. And it might, without seeking to put your hand too far up your back, be useful if the government were, perhaps in one of the debates on the bill, to express something along those lines, and if that is the government's view of what reasonable inquiries might constitute.
That's a very fair comment that Mr. Stevenson has made. I think we have to recognise that this legislation, when it's dealing with something as fundamental as the law of succession, is going to be for perhaps not forever, but it's going to be for a period of time, this the established legal position, and therefore, you know, we'll have to take account of perhaps new possibilities. I'm just surprised that Mr. Stevenson didn't mention he'd already canvassed that missing cousin as a further step taken in the 30 minutes, because I know how efficient Mr. Stevenson is in that respect. But it just goes to show in the modern era how much easier it is to identify individuals perhaps than it would have been prior to the internet being established and online data sources being obviously proliferating as time goes by. So it's a very helpful example that Mr. Stevenson has raised, and a very serious issue that we do need to reflect on and make sure the law will withstand future change.
But if I might extend it, and forgive me perhaps seeking the last word on this, I would merely make the point that we can't, I'm sure, and wouldn't want to take away the court's discretion to interpret the law. That's what they do. But at the end of the day, the man and the woman we represent doesn't want to go anywhere near a court.
There may be a balance to be struck where we keep the flexibility that Mr. Stevenson is very helpfully identifying that we should flag up, at the same time as providing as much support as we can to those who find themselves in a situation where they are acting as an executor, to understand their responsibilities and importantly give them some guidance as to how to go about their duties, if that's possible.
Super, thank you. Right, I think we then return to Stuart on private international law, is that right?
Possibly John Scott.
Thank you very much.
Possibly. Sorry, have I jumped?
17.
What question, Matt, sorry? We've done 17.
We're 19. So I would have thought we've got to. I would have thought we've dealt with that. I would have thought we were over the page.
I will deal with international law.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes. In the evidence, in particular, Professors Carruthers and Crawford have suggested that the issue of domicile is not fully resolved in what's before us, in particular in relation to the distinction between movable and heritable property, where it would be useful if the government were able to confirm that it's not the intention to assert Scottish jurisdiction over heritable property beyond our jurisdiction, where there is a local set of rules will determine the inheritance. That might be a good starting point, and whether you might wish to make the bill clearer in that respect.
I certainly will try and do my best, but I may on this point, because I know it's a fairly technical one, I may bring in my colleagues just to supplement my response to Mr. Stevenson. Certainly, I know there have been points made in relation to a potential jurisdictional gap, and we're not of the view that there is one. Although we do note the comments, particularly from Professor Carruthers in respect of this matter, the bill provisions apply only where the testator died domiciled in Scotland, and Recommendation 50 is implemented as far as it relates to the provisions in this bill. The policy intent is that it should only be possible to apply for rectification of a will if the testator died domiciled in Scotland, and this is reflected in the draft SLC bill at section 27.1. Recommendation 50 has been applied to the extent that it relates to the provisions around rectifying a will in sections 3 and 4, to which recommendation 48 restricts the application to domicile. But on the point about movable and heritable property specifically, if I may bring in my colleague Catherine McGregor on that point. deal with that?
Yes, so it was intended that, as a number of the people that come in evidence have said, private international is a fairly complex matter, and the way that the Scottish Government have dealt with it and set this bill is they've considered it on a section-by-section basis. And therefore, in respect of heritable property, I think that was in relation to Section 1, where the Law Society raised the comment about whether it should extend it to heritable property, and that wasn't our intention, but we have had discussions with the Law Society and continue to do so in respect of that. But as the Minister mentioned, in respect of Sections 3 and 4, the rectification was limited. I think that was a particular point where that Professor Carruthers made in respect of the jurisdictional gap and why we hadn't extended the application there to movable property. And the reason was that Recommendation 48 of the SLC report, which specifically referred to those sections, only applied that to domicile in respect of heritable property.
Let me just be clear. In relation to someone domiciled in Scotland, so it's been determined under Scots law, but where the will has been written in another jurisdiction and relates to heritable property in the jurisdiction in which the will was written, are we saying that the Scots process can rectify the disposition of the heritable property in that foreign jurisdiction, subject, of course, to any overriding local laws that might prevail?
In this one, Camina?
I'll defer to Catherine, but yes, I think that would be the case.
Yeah, I was going to confirm, yeah, that's my understanding, that wouldn't apply to the foreign movable property or heritable property you referred to there.
So that is basically the general principle of international law as it exists.
Yes.
Well, that's fine.
Okay.
Right. Okay. If that deals with that, then I think gifts in contemplation of death, section 20. We're back to John Scott, please.
Professor Paisley, also supported by Professor Crothers and Trustbar, took issue with the drafting of section 20. Professor Paisley, memory, described it as logically incoherent. Does the Minister wish to comment on the drafting of this provision? Do you share his views or not?
Perhaps I can put it in the terms that this wording is to make it clear that the abolition of the donation mortis causa as a distinct legal does not prevent an individual from making a gift subject to the same conditions and similar circumstances, that is, in contemplation of death. The only change in the law is that the conditions are no longer automatic. The evidence provided to the committee appears to overlook the distinction between, in the first hand, abolition of the special form of gift called the donation mortis causa, and secondly, a gift made by someone in contemplation of his or her death with express conditions other than in that special form. Section 51(2) of the Commission Bill was included so as to resolve any doubt which might arise on the abolition of the customary mode of gift known as a donation mortis causa, about the ability of people to make gifts subject to conditions in the sort of circumstances in which the customary mode of gift might previously been deployed. Take a breath after that. But having said this, the words in the question were not part of the SLC bill, and we will therefore further reflect on the concerns raised in evidence and whether this section requires to be amended at stage two. So it is one that we will perhaps come back to, along with the other points that have been raised earlier, come back to the committee as to whether we believe an amendment is required to address the concerns that Mr. Scott has directed me to look at.
Grateful for that. Thank you very much.
Can I just ask then, is it drafted the way it is because you don't put inverted commas in statutes? Because I think if we were writing that in normal English, then donatus mortis causa or whatever would be in inverted commas to mean it was this set of words.
I believe that's correct, Convener, but I'll just check with colleagues.
Yeah, it's really a matter for the draftsman, but I would think that would be the case.
Or it'd be italicized or something.
Yeah, italicized, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, well, if that's the... I guess if that's the way we write law, so
italicized in my notes, Convener, so yes, I believe that would be the case.
Okay, if that's the problem, so be it. Right, I was going to move on to ancillary powers, but do colleagues have any other substantial questions on anything else at the moment? Right, just wondering if I could pick up then, Minister, on a basic point, which is exercising us in general as a committee, that this statute, like
pretty much every other one has ancillary provisions, and Section 25 happens to be it. It's drafted in terms that are not the same as other statutes, and it's entirely unclear to us on every occasion why they are in different forms, presumably because somebody thought they were supposed to have different meanings, but it usually seems unclear what those might be. Do you have any comment on these particular ancillary powers, and do you take the point that maybe we could do with a standard set of words unless there really is a need for another one?
Well, certainly on the latter point, I will certainly take that away and discuss with colleagues as to whether there is a standard form of words that might make the life of committees easier in this respect. I appreciate the point that the convener makes. In terms of the rationale for having ancillary powers in relation to this bill, we do note from the committee report that you accept in principle that ancillary powers provision is appropriate to this bill. Just to stress that we very much would highlight that any such powers would be exercised using an affirmative procedure, and obviously the Parliament will have its chance to scrutinise in detail those provisions and ensure that they are robust and deliver the policy intent. So I hope that gives comfort to the committee that that Parliament will not miss its chance to point any flaws in provisions that come forward, but that we do believe that it's a proportionate approach here and would avoid the necessity to use primary legislation to deliver the intent of the bill.
Indeed. Thank you very much. I think that concludes our questions. Can I thank you very much for your attendance? This has been a very challenging and interesting experience. We'll have to go and reflect on all the evidence. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I'll briefly suspend to enable.
Thank you very much.
Folk to.
please. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item 3, which is instruments subject to the affirmative procedure. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Environmental Regulation Enforcement Measures Scotland Order 2015 draft, nor on the Criminal Justice and Licensing Scotland Act 2010 Supplementary Provision Order 2015 draft, nor on the Private Rented Housing Panel Landlord Application Scotland Regulations 2015 draft. Is the committee content with these instruments, please? Thank you. Agenda item 4 is instruments subject to negative procedure, the Tuberculosis in Specified Animals Scotland Order 2015, SSI 2015-327. This instrument contains a minor drafting error. Article 2.1 contains an OTOS definition of authorised veterinary inspector. The order refers in various places to a veterinary inspector only. Does the committee agree to draw the order to the attention of the Parliament on the general reporting ground in respect of a minor drafting error?
Yes.
Does the committee agree to note and accept the Scottish Government has undertaken to remove the OTOS definition by amendment in due course? Thank you. The Legal Aid Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulations 2015, SSI 2015-337. This instrument fails to observe the requirements of Section 28(2) of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2010. The instrument was laid before the Parliament on the 17th of December and came into force on the 22nd of September. The requirement to leave a minimum of 28 days between laying and coming into force has therefore not been complied with. Scottish Government has explained that the amendments to legal aid provision introduced by the instrument were required to be in force as at 22nd of September when various provisions of the Court Reform Scotland Act 2014 come into force. The amendments seek to ensure legal aid provision will operate effectively in respect of, amongst other things, the new Sheriff Appeal Court established by that Act. The committee will also note that the Scottish Government has proposed to make amendments to existing legal aid provision via an affirmative instrument, which was laid before the Parliament on the 9th of June and was considered by the committee at its meeting on the 23rd of June. The draft instrument was withdrawn on the 17th of September following concerns raised by the Justice Committee at its meetings on the 8th and 15th of September. The instrument before the committee today was laid before the Parliament on the 17th of September and makes substantially the same amendments as those proposed in the earlier draft affirmative instrument, but with specific changes to those proposed amendments which seek to address the concerns raised by the Justice Committee. Does the committee agree to draw the instrument to the attention of the Parliament on reporting ground J, as there has been a failure to observe the requirements of Section 28(2) of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2010? Does the committee agree to accept the Scottish Government's explanation for the failure to observe these requirements? Thank you. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the National Health Service Payments and Remission of Charges Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulations 2015, SSI 2015-333, nor on the Mental Health Tribunal for Scotland Practice and Procedure No. 2, Amendment Rules 2015, SSI 2015-334. Is the committee content with these instruments, please?
Yes.
Agenda item 5, instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Criminal Justice and Licensing Scotland Act 2010, Commencement No. 13, and the Courts Reform Scotland Act 2014, Commencement No. 4, Order 2015, SSI 2015-336. Are we content with this instrument, please?
Yes.
Thank you. Agenda item 6, the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Scotland Bill. The purpose of this item is to consider the delegated powers provisions in the bill as amended at stage 2. The stage 3 debate for this bill will take place on Thursday, the 1st of October. The committee should therefore agree its conclusions today so they can be captured in a report prior to the debate. Members will have noted that Scottish Government has provided a supplementary delegated powers memorandum and will have seen the briefing paper for the committee. It is proposed that members may wish to find all the newer amended delegated powers acceptable. Do members have any comments? Or does the committee agree to report that it's content with the provisions in the bill, which have been amended at stage 2 to insert or substantially alter provisions conferring powers to make subordinate legislation or other delegated powers?
Yes.
We do. Thank you very much. That completes item 6, and I now move this meeting into private. Thank you.